Mary Tyler Moore, 4 o'clock weekdays on Channel 5.
This is the weekend edition of News Center 5 with Mike Jackson at the anchor desk and Carol Marine. All the Weather with Jerry Taft. And Sports Sunday with Greg Gumbel and Mike Leiderman.
The news desk today is brought to you by Amoco Oil Company. At Amoco, you expect more from a leader.
Good evening, I'm Mike Jackson. It's predicted the temperature will drop to 20 below zero tonight. Our Jerry Taft will have details on that.
And it looks like the CTA tonight may be in some hot water. We'll have those stories coming up. Mike?
Carol, there may be some hot water in City Hall this week. The story of millions of dollars for consulting reports paid by the city of Chicago, apparently to political pals, continues to lead our news this evening. Tomorrow, City Hall has promised to release all of the consulting contracts for 1978, so we can see where all the money went. Now, Mayor Blandick has refused to discuss the contracts. He did that today, as did others at City Hall. But the mayor's political opponent in the primary later this month is talking. Jane Byrne today is calling for the resignation of CTA Chairman James McDonough. In what appeared, in addition to the job, the former city streets and sanitation commissioner is connected with some firms receiving more than $3 million in city consulting contracts.
There is no leadership when the man in charge apparently is a bit busier getting $3 million worth of non-bid contracts for his employers than in running the CTA during this crisis. The list of contracts released on Friday showed that Murphy Engineering and a sister company, which Mr. McDonough is with, received more than $3 million in no-bid contracts under the Blandick administration.
CTA Chairman McDonough told us he will not discuss the $3 million in city contracts until a news conference tomorrow.
And that's about the same time we get to see the contracts themselves. NewsCenter 5 has been asking to see those contracts and the consultants' reports. City Hall has refused to release any of the reports, although one suit has been filed, and NewsCenter 5 may be filing another one. Late Tuesday, our reporter, Dick Kay, went to the office of city purchasing agent James Arnold. He delivered a letter requesting more details on city contracts, who gets them, how much they're paid, and what they're about. Wednesday, Kay returned, asking for the daily award sheets, lists of contracts awarded, lists which have been public under Mayor Daley. Thursday, Arnold promised Dick Kay the information.
Here's the secretary. Mr. Kay, that will be made available to you. I said, I'll call your office as soon as they're available, and you can send someone over to pick them up. You will get a call from me personally when they're available.
Well, when am I going to get a look at the service that the consultants, professional services, contracts themselves, as opposed to the daily award sheets?
They'll be made available to you as soon as they're all gathered up, and I will again call you when they're ready.
Any idea when that will be, how long that will take?
It should be done shortly, within the next few days.
Friday, we got those daily award sheets, and as we said last night, tomorrow we should be able to tell you more about those millions that were spent. Mike?
News for CTA commuters isn't great for tomorrow. The Skokie Swift may have more trouble, nothing definite yet. And generally, service will be no better than it was last Friday. Here's a report from Lynne Scott.
Push in. At the most, only 600 CTA trains will be capable of running during the rush hour tomorrow morning. This year's record snowfall has knocked the other one-fourth of the system's trains out of commission. And with the temperatures expected to dip below zero, the number could be slimmed still further. And that may mean even longer delays this week for the 500,000 CTA commuters.
We don't know until early tomorrow morning exactly how many cars we will have available. This time we think there will be just about the same numbers last week. But this is a very fluid situation, operating a rapid transit system. And things can happen en route, unanticipated delays, over which no one has any idea beforehand.
But what concerns CTA officials most is the prospect of more derailments, like the one last week on the Lake Dan Ryan. Miraculously, no one was injured in that accident, which CTA officials now believe was caused by the weather. Just 2 years ago today, 11 people were killed, 180 others injured in a similar accident. Two trains on the Lake Dan Ryan collided, and four cars tumbled to the pavement below. Officials say they will do everything to prevent more accidents from occurring, even if that means lengthy delays for commuters during Monday morning rush hour. Lynne Scott, NewsCenter 5.
Despite the problems on the CTA, only one regional transit authority commuter train has been canceled tomorrow, the Rock Island Route 612. Now, that's the one that leaves from Blue Island about 7 o'clock in the morning. All the other RTA trains on all of the lines are supposed to be on schedule.
Aldermanic candidate Chester Blair today said he wants to sue the CTA for cutting rush hour service on the Lake Street Dan Ryan line last week on the south and the west side. Blair says he wants the names of the people who were fired or gave up their jobs because they couldn't use the L. He says it's one thing to ignore the city's minorities and another thing to make the minorities lose their jobs. There's much more in our expanded newscast tonight, including Barry Bernson starting a six-part series on Hollywood and Jerry Taft. Jerry Taft?
Well, it's going to be very cold tomorrow morning. If your car starts, you got a good deal. The suburbs may hit 20 below zero by rush hour tomorrow morning. Mike?
I love that chair. Some better news. Martina Navratilova has won the Chicago Women's Pro Tennis Tournament for the second straight year. She beat Tracy Austin today, and we'll have expanded highlights. Greg?
And the Chicago Blackhawks have just defeated the New York Islanders. The NBA All-Stars played, plus boxing, skiing, skating, and a sudden-death finish in golf. All of that, Carol.
All of that is coming up later in the program.
Mike?
Yeah,
that's true. We'll take a break right now and come back with more news, including a late report, Deng Xiaoping's tour of the Boeing plant in Seattle. Stay with us.
All over America, Amoco is working to make our country less dependent on foreign oil. Here on the Utah-Wyoming border, Amoco helped open up 8 new oil and natural gas fields where it was once thought unlikely deposits would ever be found. New supplies like this mean fewer dollars have to go overseas for imported oil, and that helps America's balance of payments. The result is a stronger American dollar, and that's good for all Americans.
America, cut your gas heat bill up to 20%. Turn your pilot light off for keeps. And put the miser on your furnace. The miser works two ways. It eliminates the gas-wasting pilot and closes the flue whenever the burner is off. So all that heat you paid for stays inside, cutting your gas heat bill up to 20%. The miser from Johnson Controls.
Look for the dealer nearest you. Call 236-6000 or look for the miser ad in Sunday's Chicago Tribune.
We're in the yellow. We're in the yellow.
The yellow pages, it's good business for me.
When you're in the yellow, you've got an ad that works for you 24 hours a day, 365 days a year.
An ad in the yellow pages gets people when they're ready to buy. Get in the yellow. It's good business.
Get in the yellow. We said the yellow. The yellow pages, it's where you should be.
Introducing Hertz takeoff rates. Save up to 35% on the average weekday rental when you take off Thursday through Sunday for a minimum of 2 to 3 days. Take off in a subcompact for only $13.95 a day. Fairmont's $15.95. Granada's $17.95. Thunderbird's $21.95 a day. All with no charge for mileage. There are some restrictions, so check with Hertz. Take off next weekend with Hertz low takeoff rate.
Last weekend, two brothers from Bolingbrook, 18-year-old Christopher Rika and 16-year-old John Rika, were found shot to death in Wheatland Township. This weekend, two people have been charged with those murders, 20-year-old John Savo of Romeoville and an unnamed 16-year-old youth. Not only do police believe the murders were drug-related, police say the dead brothers, John and Christopher Rika, were buyers and sellers of drugs. An off-duty Skokie policeman shot and killed a 38-year-old Lincolnwood man today. Dead is Ronald Hind, who, according to police, threatened to shoot the off-duty officer during a traffic dispute. No charges were pressed against that officer. Mike?
It now seems likely that early this week, a Livingston County grand jury will begin handing down some indictments for the murder of three guards in the Pontiac prison riot last July. Bloomington radio station WJBC is claiming that its informed sources believe 15 or more inmates are expected to be indicted. At Stateville Prison in Joliet today, an inmate walked away from the prison's honor farm. 27-year-old Willie Roberts was doing 2 to 6 years for burglary. Authorities are still trying to find him. Just yesterday, another inmate walked away from the Joliet Work Release Center. That inmate, Richard Johnson, surrendered 7 hours later.
The battle lines are being drawn in Iran. Prime Minister Shapour Bakhtiar saying he will answer Molotov cocktail for Molotov cocktail, any attempt by his opponents to take over the government. This after the Ayatollah Khomeini threatened a holy war unless Bakhtiar steps down. In the middle of the political chaos in Iran, the new shaky government has suddenly decided to cancel $10 billion worth of military contracts. Included in the cuts are 160 early Dynamics F-16 fighter planes, some of the most sophisticated in the world, worth almost $4 billion. The Washington Post reports in today's editions that the reason for that cancellation of orders was because Iran didn't have the money because of the loss of revenue due to the disruption of oil production. CIA Director Stansfield Turner today admitted his agency failed to predict the political turmoil in Iran, which eventually led to the ouster of the Shah. However, Turner said that even Muslim leader Ayatollah Khomeini himself did not know beforehand the power of his followers.
It was like a series of volcanoes bubbling. But it certainly appeared that no one of them would bubble up so much the government couldn't control it. What we didn't forecast was that a single man, a 78-year-old cleric who had been in exile for 14 years, would be a catalyst that would bring these forces together, and we had one huge volcano, a truly national revolution. It means we've got to do better at looking at the socio-political happenings in countries.
Turner said the rest of the world's intelligence agencies also didn't foresee the fall of the Shah.
From Washington tonight, a report which says the military services intelligence standards are too high. Democrat Les Aspin of Wisconsin opposes renewing the draft, and he says one way to avoid that is the effective use of people he says have low intelligence scores. In Seattle today, Chinese Vice Premier Dong said China will change its immigration policies to qualify for low American tariffs. All of this came about after Dong visited the Boeing factory in Seattle. Stephen Delaney reports.
On Deng Xiaoping's tour of industrial America, this was Seattle Day, which means it was Boeing Day. They took him to see the big ones in the building where they make the 747. The Chinese have already ordered a few, and if they're serious about being in the airline business, they'll need more. The vice premier was wearing his gee whiz expression again, as he has while touring other plants in this country earlier this week. Tomorrow, he meets editors and publishers from the Northwest in the morning, and then leaves on the long flight back to Peking in a Boeing airplane. At this point, both the Americans and the Chinese seem to believe that this trip has been a success and that normalization is off to a pretty good start. Steve Delaney, NBC News, Seattle.
Among the people greeting Deng in Seattle today was 52-year-old Woo Young-soon, a Korean who wanted to hand the Chinese leader a bouquet of carnations. That was nice, but while Ms. Woo waited outside, a police horse came along and ate them. Rotten deal. Coming up next, Jerry Taft and word of freezing temperatures and the fear of a dam collapse in Marion, Illinois. We'll have both of those stories as we continue.
Barry Bernson introduces us to a man with a long career in the movie industry. Though you probably never heard of him, his name really is Hollywood.
To all the taxpayers in America who should file the short form, H&R Block announces the short and sweet deal. Now, the short part is we'll prepare your short form in short order. The sweet part is we'll do it for only $7.50. Think of it. Only $7.50, and we'll do any state or local return for even less. So short form filers, come to H&R Block and get yourself a short and sweet deal.
A&P has its own standards for buying meat, so the meat you buy there tastes like it comes from a butcher shop at supermarket prices.
Another reason why you'll do better at A&P.
Stop in at the A&P nearest you for country-style sliced bacon, just 99 cents a pound. And delicious fresh Florida white seedless grapefruit, a 5-pound bag for only 79 cents through Wednesday.
Morning, Henry.
Something sure smells good.
There's plenty. Come on.
Anyone who insists on fresh, wholesome food knows where to find Bob Evans Farm Sausage. Because we do it right, or we don't do it. Bob Evans pork sausage gets its healthy pink look from fresh, lean meat, not colorings or preservatives.
You sure do a breakfast up right.
Henry, you buttering me up.
Down the farm, we do it right, or we don't do it.
It's here, Chicago, the 24th Magnavox annual sale at your Chicagoland Magnavox dealer, with big savings plus instant factory rebate checks of up to $50 ready to be made out to you. Get a $20 instant rebate on this 19-inch portable color TV, plus a decorator base free. This decorator console stereo has a $50 instant rebate, and this touch-tune console color TV includes a $50 instant rebate and a free remote control. So buy now during the 24th Magnavox annual sale at your Chicagoland Magnavox dealer.
A showdown tomorrow. A northwest suburban community is set to fight a court order that the Lake Marion Dam in Kane County is unsafe and that the lake must be drained. Residents say the Army Corps of Engineers surprised them when they ruled that the dam was unsafe. They want a second opinion. Gene Randall was there today and has this report.
Snow and ice covered now, Lake Marion is 25 years old. 15 acres of spring-fed water held in check by an earthen dam. More than 250 families live here. About 50 of them have homes either on or near the lakeshore. These are the people who feel they would be hurt the worst by the Corps of Engineers' plan. The Corps says an inspection it made last April showed that the dam was unsafe. And unless there is successful legal action to stop it, a Kane County Circuit Court judge has ruled that work to drain the lake and breach the dam will begin tomorrow. This afternoon, the Lake Marion Property Owners Association met to map out a strategy of opposition.
Our lawyer's working on papers right now, and if things work out all right, sometime tomorrow, we'll sit there and they won't be able to come on the dam.
Much of what we heard today seemed almost an echo of the controversy we heard last year surrounding Lake in the Hills, just 5 miles from here. There, too, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers cited an earthen dam as unsafe. The lack of success the Lake in the Hills Property Owners Association had fighting the Corps is one more element of concern here for the future of Lake Marion and its earthen dam. Gene Randall, NewsCenter 5.
Jerry Taft has the awesome chore of telling us how cold it's going to get tonight.
How
it's getting lower and lower.
No, it's going to be very cold out tonight, Mike. As a matter of fact, today wasn't exactly the warmest day of the year. We had a low temperature this morning of 5 below zero and a high this afternoon of only 3 above. That's 30 degrees below normal. Well, look at our current temperatures and you get some idea that temperatures are still on the way down. Right now it's 2 below at both Midway and Northbrook, 1 at O'Hare, 0 at the lakefront, and 2 below at Gary. We have a wind chill factor of 28 degrees below zero. Now, in order for it to get this cold, there's really three factors that are helping us here. Well, I shouldn't say helping us, because we certainly don't want it to get this cold. First of all, we have a lot of snow on the ground, so that keeps it from heating up too much during the day. The second thing is that we have clear skies, so that lets any heat that we have radiate out. And the third thing is that tonight we're going to have light winds. At least if we had some winds, it would mix it up a little bit and force us to cool maybe 2,000 or 3,000 feet. But as long as we have light winds like this, it's going to be very cold here at the surface. So tonight, bitter cold, I guess is what you'd have to call it. Temperatures will be ranging from 10 below at the lakefront, 15 below out at Midway, and out at DuPage County, it could hit 20 degrees below zero. Let's take a look at the records. First of all, before midnight, 13 below is the record. I don't think we're going to hit that because we're only 2 below now. But after midnight, when the winds die down a little bit, the record is only, well, I shouldn't say only, but the record is 15 below zero. We have a good chance of breaking that record. The all-time lowest temperature ever recorded in Chicago, 23 below back in 1872. There's an outside chance that we could touch that, but it really doesn't look too good. But all in all, a very cold night coming up. We're going to take a commercial break, and after that, we'll take a look at the rest of the week after we get this cold air out of the way, right after this word.
Tomorrow only at Sears.
For most of the week, there's certainly no thaw in sight, and we also have two chances for snow this week. First of all, on Tuesday, and then again on Friday. I don't see any big snowstorms, but we do have two chances for light snow. Here's a look at the World Satellite. You can see a lot of moisture through Mexico and Texas, certainly nothing here. If we zoom in the satellite to the U.S., you can see that moisture down to the south of us and also some moisture out to the west. There's a few snow showers on the eastern side of the Great Lakes, some light rain and drizzle in Texas, and some rain with this next system, which will turn to snow as it moves our way. We have very cold Arctic air over us, Gulf and Pacific moisture to the south interacting with that Arctic air. That's the reason for all the clouds and the rain down there. But that's not going to be affecting us here in Chicago. But if we look at the Pacific world shot, actually zoom the lens of the satellite all the way out, you can see one little curlicue storm right here. This storm will move across the northern plains, move to the north of Chicago Tuesday morning, but we could get some light snow out of that. And then there's another storm over by Hawaii that will slip in here sometime during the day on Friday. So two chances for snow. Let's look at our forecast now. Tonight, we're looking for clear skies and record low temperatures. Lows ranging from 10 below at the lakefront to 20 below in the suburbs. And tomorrow, sunny and very cold with a high temperature of only 7 degrees. And then for the rest of the week, a little bit of light snow on Tuesday, sunshine Wednesday and Thursday, and more snow on Friday. But as you can see from all those temperatures, not even approaching the freezing mark at all this week. Carol?
Thank you, Jerry. Tonight we begin a six-part series with Barry in Hollywood. Barry, of course, is our film critic and feature reporter Barry Bernson, and in his first segment, he combines those beats, introducing us to a man who really is Mr. Hollywood.
The city of Los Angeles is surrounded on three sides by geographical phenomena: the desert, the mountains, and the Pacific Ocean. It may be that isolation that makes Los Angeles more than just a place. It makes it a way of life, a state of mind. And it's no coincidence that right in the middle of Los Angeles, the city of the angels, there is a sort of city of dreams. And that is a place called Hollywood.
Hollywood, said the late comedian Fred Allen, is a great place if you're an orange. Well, it's a great place too if you're in the movies. And here, even a guard at MGM's main gate considers himself in the movies. But there's a good reason.
Can I help you?
Yeah, I'm looking for Soundstage 27.
Well, you go straight ahead and you'll run right into Stage 27.
Okay, thanks. Sergeant Hollywood?
That's right.
Wow.
Okay, go right ahead.
Sergeant Ken Hollywood has been stationed here at MGM's main gate for the last 33 years. His father was a vaudeville performer, so perhaps it was not fate alone that brought a man with such an appropriate name to such a place as this.
Everybody that comes in, though, thinks it's a phony name, though.
But you can prove otherwise.
That's right.
Just show them your driver's license.
Oh, every time.
Tell me a little bit about what it was like in the old days, in the 40s, when the stars were so much a part of Hollywood.
Well, they dressed nice. They really looked like stars in those days. Clark Gable, Lana Turner, Catherine Grayson, Esther Williams, right down the line.
So you have a few more years yet at the gate.
Oh, about five.
And then you'll have a lot of memories.
That's right. Then I'll write a book.
You can see him here 5 days a week just doing his job. Movie stars may come and go, but here at least they can come and go past a man named Hollywood. From Culver City, California, Barry Bernson, NewsCenter 5.
The Chicago Blackhawks met the high-powered New York Islanders at the stadium tonight. Greg Gumbel and Mike Leiderman will be along with the final score and highlights next on Sports Sunday.
If you think the only advanced steel mills are overseas, think again. Some of them are here at United States Steel. At our Alabama plant, we're building one of the world's most efficient blast furnaces. At Gary, Indiana, we have one of the most sophisticated computer-controlled strip mills anywhere. The billet caster at our Southworks in Chicago is equal to anything you'll find abroad. Know-how. At United States Steel, it's one of our strengths.
You know why Roman meal bakers like their work? They like the smell when all that bread's in the oven. And they like the idea that they're baking something special. But there's more to Roman meal than good baking. It's what Roman meal's made with. A unique blend of select grains, rich flour, honey, ingredients that make a delicious light brown bread with natural whole grain goodness. I like that. And this Roman meal bakery thought you'd like to know.
Is short hair in, Sally?
Yes, but white gloves are out.
Not when you've got age spots.
Those brown patches? Ah, don't hide them. Faith them with Esoterica. Used daily as directed, Esoterica works below the skin surface. In most cases, age spots rise and fade off. No gloves, Mrs. Davis?
No problem, Sally. That Esoterica really works.
Don't hide age spots. Fade them with Esoterica.
Arby's is a big, juicy, fresh, wholesome.
RBQ is a mouth-watering, saucy, tangy, barbecue-flavored, beefy sandwich.
RBQ?
Meet the RBQ, another delicious change of taste at Arby's.
RBQ is a mouth-watering, saucy, tangy, barbecue-flavored, beefy sandwich.
It's the taste that's tanging the nation. Try one today at all Chicagoland Arby's.
Tennis is one of the big stories today, and here are the people to tell you about it, Greg Gumbel and Mike Leiderman.
Thank you, Carol. Martina Navratilova and Tracy Austin faced off in the finals of the Chicago Avon Tennis Tournament. Martina beat the kid, but not without some trouble.
Hawks and Islanders tonight at the stadium. NBA West beats East, and Lon Hinkle becomes a bit more famous golfing name. First, let's talk tennis. The women's final at the Chicago Avon Tournament matched the two people nearly everyone figured would be there, and the result was Martina Navratilova, the veteran of 22, overpowering 16-year-old wunderkind Tracy Austin. The score is 6-3, 6-4 to win the Chicago event for the second time running. Martina's ranked number one in the world, but Tracy coming on strong. She won the last three times these two met and started quickly today. Martina tentative at first, and you can't play that way against young Miss Austin. Tracy led 3-1 in the first set before Martina loosened up and took the offensive, and that means power. The first serve started to go in consistently, and that kept the pressure on Tracy. Martina ran off five games in a row, won the first set 6-3. Goodbye. But Austin had lost the first set in three of the four matches she'd played all week, so she wasn't ready to give up by any means. She took a 3-1 lead again in the second set, waiting for her opening. Watch this one. Tracy's mother and coach were in the stands, but it was Martina who came on strong at the end, constantly forcing play, keeping Austin on the defensive, and staying free of those unforced errors that mar her play on more than one occasion. Watch the backhand to end this fine rally by both players. Finally, for Martina, a service winner for the match, 6-3, 6-4 the scores. Martina's second straight win here for $40,000. Tracy at 16 picked up 20,000 the place. In the doubles final, sequin Rosie Casals in the forecourt and partner Betty Ann Stewart overcame some strange line calls and sloppy play to beat Greer Stevens and Ilana Kloss 3-6, 7-5, and 7-5.
Well, as close to an upset as you can get during the National Hockey League season, the Blackhawks, unbelievable as it may seem, knocked off the powerful New York Islanders at the stadium tonight. The final was 5-4 Blackhawks. First period, the Hawks got off to a great start. Stan Mikita rips a slap shot by Islander goalie Billy Smith, Stan's 12th of the year. And then Bob Murray's shot is stopped by Smith, but watch Phil Russell give it right back to Murray on the doorstep, and the Blackhawks had a 2-0 lead. But then New York came roaring back. Mike Bossy sets up Clark Gillies for one. Gillies came on to set up Brian Trottier. That's Trottier's 34th of the season, and it was a tie game at 2-2. And before the period ended, Mike Kosicki scored his 10th on Esposito, and the Islanders had a 3-2 lead after one. In the second period, Cliff Coral for Mikita again, and Stan tied it up at three goals apiece, and the Hawks, playing well tonight, began looking for the victory. There's Stan. Mikita went looking for the hat trick, but watch what happens. Mike Bossy on the breakaway, and a 4-3 New York lead as the teams went into period number three. But the Hawks played tough defense while Reg Kerr set up Grant Mulvey for the tying goal, Mulvey scoring on Billy Smith. Then with 8.5 minutes to play, Dave Logan.